हेलो हेलो, आई एम ऑडिबल? हेलो,
यस
ओके,
यस
थैंक यू
सर।
मैडम। एचओडी मैडम, मे वी स्टार्ट? मैडम
यस यू मे स्टार्ट प्लीज।
मैडम ओके, गुड आफ्टरनून टू our respected HOD madam, Dr. Helena Sengupta, Civil Engineering Department, University, and a very good afternoon to our esteemed speaker, Mrs. Ankona Ganguly madam, and also to all of our participants and colleagues. Okay, so today we are going to organize a very good webinar on hello. Yes,
carry on, please.
Okay. Yeah. So today we are organized a very good webinar on some innovative ideas of waterproofing and roofing in today's construction. And now I am requesting to our HOD madam for giving an inaugural speech in this regard. Madam, please.
Thank you, Argo. Thank you, Argo. And
thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. My dear students, my dear colleagues, and Mrs. Ankona Ganguly also. We at Techno India University, Department of Civil Engineering, have always encouraged our students to explore and develop their innovative ideas. Innovation in the initiative of developing and promoting products and services which are made in India, we have been encouraging all of you to become entrepreneurs using the innovative ideas that you are having. We, in this context, in association with IICTIU and Students Chapter of Indian Institute of Engineers, have brought today Mrs. Ankona Ganguly, who is a General Manager, Specification and Technical STP Limited. She's a BTech in Polymer Science and Technology from Calcutta University. She would be speaking about the innovative ideas of waterproofing and roofing in today's construction. I request all of you to take this opportunity to expand your horizons and get enriched by the knowledge that she would be sharing. I welcome Mrs. Ankona Ganguly to this webinar, and I request you to please take over the session. Mrs. Ankona Ganguly, please.
Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon to you, good afternoon to Orgho sir, and good afternoon to my young audience today. Thank you so much for joining me today and today's virtual wall. These days we are more and more likely to find ourselves giving remote presentations to virtual audience, virtual room full of audience, clients, students, and of course our own colleagues. We are also getting accustomed with the new reality, new normal, and trying to adapt to life during this pandemic. We hope you are all staying healthy and safe. Thank you so much. Now let us talk about something with which we all are very much familiar with, and at the same time the subject is unknown too. This is waterproofing. Just a second. Can you visualize my screen?
Yes ma'am.
Fine. So now we will be discussing waterproofing today. Okay, and in our second edition we will be discussing on flooring. So today our topic is waterproofing. So as I have said, that this is familiar, we are very much familiar with this, but at the same time we also do not know very much, the detailings, the complexity of waterproofing. So today we will be discussing a little bit chemistry, a little bit application of the waterproofing and structures. Okay, so now This is a very beautiful slide for you. We will be surprised to know that concrete, the structures, behave like humans, normal human beings. You know what? When we create concrete structures, we need to have water. Okay? So we need water to sprinkle for curing. We need water to create concrete, right? But after creating the structure, do we want water inside? We do not want. So the waterproofing, by the name of waterproofing, waterproofing itself says about its nature, that the structure should be completely watertight. So we should not allow a single drop of water inside. Just like the human being, when a baby is born, you know, before a baby is born, the entire environment is with water. That time it needs water. But after, when the baby is born, then if we create this type of environment, in the surroundings, if we create like this, then it would be detrimental for him or her. So this is exactly the way, you know, the human behaves. Now, again, you will be surprised to know that when the concrete ages, then in concrete, there are cracks, there are wrinkles in the structure. And we can just correlate this with us also. When we age, the normal human beings, they age. Then they develop wrinkles, then they develop cracks in their skin. So you can always correlate. This is just like us, concrete behaves. You know, the skin of human beings, these are porous. So there will be exchange of moisture vapor, right? We sweat. So moisture vapor comes out, and in the form of sweating, it comes out. But the concrete, at the same time, this is also porous. And concrete also breathes. Like moisture vapor comes out, moisture vapor comes in. So the environment, that air, the pollutants also comes in. So it's the way the concrete behaves, the same way we also behave. Again, the joints. When we age, we should be cautious about our joints, right? So at the same time, concrete also has joints. So if we do not take care of the joints properly in the concrete, then, you know, we'll be gone. From the joints, there can be water percolation, and water may come inside in the structure. Then our client will be, you know, we will be out from the project. So we do not want this. So we have to be extra cautious about the joints. Now let us talk about a bit chemistry. We all know what is cement. Cement is the controlled combination of the materials like calcium, aluminium, iron, silica, etc., etc. There are many ingredients. So this is the controlled combination. We may say this is a controlled oxidation process. Okay, so this is a controlled combination of these materials. So from this slide, you can see the entire industrial process, how we create cements from clinkers or from calcium carbonate. So this is the process. So you have read this in your textbooks. So I wanted to give you some glimpses again. So how do we process? How do we create cements? Okay. Now, as I have already said, these are the oxidation process of the part of the composition of the components, basic components of cement, right? So this is what? Calcium, silica, aluminium, and iron, these are getting oxidized. And what is the fate of this? After oxidation, it creates calcium oxide, silicon dioxide, aluminium oxides, and ferric oxides. These are the main components of cement. So these are getting oxidized. And there would be combination of these also in the cement, like C3S, tricalcium silicate. These are the components we knew now that, you know, these would be calcium oxide, silicon dioxide, aluminium oxide, and ferric oxide. These components also combine with and create the component of cement. These are what? Tricalcium silicate, dicalcium silicate, tricalcium aluminate, and tetracalcium aluminoferrite. These are the basic components of cement. And there are many other components too. Magnesium, sodium, sulfur, potassium, etc., etc. So there are many other components there, but these are the main components: calcium, silica, aluminium, and iron. Okay, we all know, but that just a recapitulation. So nothing beyond that. Okay. So now, cement we all know. Now with the cement, with the cement dust, we cannot do anything. This is just dust. So we cannot create any structure out of this. So what to do? Now we have to add some additives into it. What are they? We can add water. Water is it is very important. When we add water, it will create some pasty substance in cement. So it can be like slurry. What is slurry? This can be a paintable coat. Sometimes we need a paintable coat with cement. Sometimes. Okay. So when water is added with cement, this can be a paint-like thing. So we can paint some structures with this cement slurry. And that is why we call it slurry or paint. Then sand can be also added to create some mortars. What do we call it? Mortar. When water, cement will be added with sand, this will create mortar. Mortar, where do we apply this kind of mortar? Sometimes, you know, in our buildings, there can be spalling, you know. So the concrete chunks may come out. This is called spalling. So we need some kind of repair mortar to rebuild it. So this is called mortar. Now, when the aggregates are being added in this water, cement, sand mix, then what do we call it? Concrete. But in concrete, this is just only concrete. I mean, there is no reinforcement. So this type of concrete is called PCC, plain cement concrete. So what is PCC? There is no reinforcement. It is only plain concrete, which is being applied in many of our structures. Like suppose at the rooftop, you know, suppose after doing the waterproofing course, we need to have some sloping screed. So that there, you know, this PCC comes in the picture. That is a plain cement concrete. There is no reinforcement added into it. This is only concrete. So we can create slope with this on the rooftop. Otherwise, in the basement also, you know, I will be discussing the basement. What are the layers of the basement? You know what? I mean, the PCC is the basic level. I mean, PCC is the first level of this basement. So that is also the plain cement concrete. After comes waterproofing, other things. So that is also an application of PCC. And of course, RCC. What is that? I mean, in PCC, if we add reinforcement, the rebars, the steel rebars, if we add, then it becomes RCC. That means reinforced cement concrete. RCC is the main structure of a building. Okay, so RCC means, you know, the pillars, the beams, suppose we have basements in the structure, that is also the structure, main structure of our, that is made with RCC. Roof slab, main slab, mother slab, this is also RCC. So the main structure, wherever there will be the main structure, it will be formed with RCC. And of course, water is the main thing. Water is the most important thing which should be added with the mix. Otherwise, we cannot prepare the mix. What we call after application of water, we call it hydration. So the cement, the mix has been hydrated with water, and there will be some ratio, obviously, which will be associated with water. We cannot just add water, I mean water we cannot add, I mean, indefinitely. There will be a certain limit. So we have to abide by the rule of this limit. This is called water cement ratio. So this is a proper ratio for any mix. The water cement ratio is a must, and water cement ratio will be different for different mixes. So this ratio is very, very important whenever we are creating concrete. This ratio is very important when we are creating mortars. This is very important when we are creating slurry. So it has to have some limit. So we must abide by the rule. Okay. Now, this is the biggest challenge in structures. Many a times, you know, these pictures are very common in our day-to-day lives. So many a times we just come across this type of things, right? The dampness, seepages, leakages, you know, the painting, many a times we can see the paint may peel off. So this kind of thing happens, right? But we do not want this kind of things. So we have to have some precautionary measures to come out of this. Now, the aging process these are different aging process of the structures. When the structure ages, then this kind of things may happen. What are this kind of things? These are very, very, very common in our life. I mean, sometimes we can see this type of fungus development in the structure. You know, after this fungus development, you know, we can see the black patches on the structure. So these are nothing but fungus. Sometimes this kind of efflorescence can happen. Efflorescence, what? I mean, many a times in Salt Lake areas, you know, in buildings, these are very, very common. So at the ground level, at the ground floor level, over the GPC, actually, you know, this type of efflorescence may come out. Okay, this is, we call saltpeters. So some salts are there over the substrate, and water patches, you know, damp patches are there with it. So these are called efflorescence. We do not want this, and we have rectification. We have some measures to rectify this. So we will be discussing slowly. And this type of paint peel off, these are very common, right? So this can also happen sometimes. So it is not a, then if it peels off, then we have to understand that the paint doesn't have proper bond with the substrate. Okay, so this is a bond failure of the paint. So we need to have some precautionary measures, right? Carbonation. Of course, carbonation is a very bad thing in concrete. So in today's life, there are pollutions everywhere. The pollutants are there in the environment. So we know that pH of concrete is 12.5 to 13, right? So this is the environment in the concrete is basic. So whenever this pH gets reduced, then it is alarming for the concrete. We should not allow the carbonation to happen in our concrete structures. If it happens, then pH of the concrete gets reduced, and as a result, there can be the corrosion in the concrete rebar. These are nothing but mainly due to carbon dioxide, which actually reacts with the base of the concrete, and it creates carbonic acid. So, and carbonic acid, we know this is acidic. So slowly, actually the pH gets reduced. So don't worry, we have solutions for that. We can avoid carbonation by putting some protective coating over the concrete. So we will be discussing that. Now, of course, corrosion. So we have already discussed corrosion happens due to carbonation mainly. For other things also, it can happen. So for if there will be cracks on the concrete, you know, I mean, there also, you know, sometimes corrosions can happen. I mean, this is due to the environment, the polluting environment, which is with carbon dioxide and with other hazardous gases. So this is the acidic environment which can create the problem in my concrete, which is basic. And these are the cracks which sometimes may be ASR induced cracks. ASR, what? This is alkali silica reaction in the concrete. Probably we all know what it is. We actually do not want this to happen, but things are not in our hand. Sometimes it happens when, you know, that's different form of silica of this aggregates combines with the reacts with the alkalis in cement with water, then it forms this kind of gel, alkali silica gel. So this gels, actually these are the size of the gels are very much bigger, and you know, when it forms, it occupies some place in the concrete. When it occupies some place in the concrete, it actually creates some pressure in the concrete. And due to pressure, cracks can happen. So this is what, I mean, we do not want in our concrete, but this can happen. Now, as we know that concrete ages, during this aging process, what is most, I mean, common feature we can see visually, the cracks. This is a very important thing we have to understand, the cracks. If the cracks happen due to aging process, then we have to have some corrective measures. Now we have defined, we have actually categorized this. I mean, the various factors also are responsible for the concrete aging process. So we have categorized these factors into three. One is pre-construction factors. Pre-construction means before construction. Before construction also, we have responsibilities to create a complete watertight, a sound structure. So we have responsibilities. Of course, post-construction factors are there. So post-construction factors, but this is not in our hand. It can happen after construction. So these are also, I mean, few factors we will be discussing, and other factors like, you know, earthquake, flood, fire, the natural disaster. This is also not in our hand, right? So these kind of factors are responsible for the concrete aging. Okay, so we have to understand it properly. What are the factors? Pre-construction factors. Pre-construction means before construction. Before construction, we have to be cautious about few things. The engineering. We all are engineers. We know how to create a good design, a better design of the structure. Sometimes, you know, I mean, the concrete fails, the structure fails due to design also. So design faults may be there. So we have to be cautious for that. Raw materials, of course, the raw materials we are using for the structure, to create the structure, we have to be extra cautious for that. There should not be any pollutants, any, you know, other things which can deteriorate our concrete faster. So we need to be cautious. We have to procure the raw materials from a very good, trusted agency, so that this can be minimized. Workmanship. This is probably the most important thing. Even if the good design, even if the raw materials handling, proper raw materials handling, the structure may fail because of the application, the workmanship. So the contractors should be good, you know, contractors or applicators should do a good work. Okay, and they should be, you know, they should be educated always, so that they can create a structure which will be ultimately it can be a very good structure. So application or workmanship is very, very important. Now coming to post-construction factors, there are many actually. Okay, suppose sometimes, you know, the expansion contraction. So we all know that concrete expands during summer due to heat, it expands, and when in winter or at night when the temperature comes down, it may contract. So expansion and contraction always happen in concrete. So for that, we need to design the concrete properly. We need to have joints, we need to have different type of joints actually, expansion joints, contraction joints, control joints, different type of joints are there. So we need to create our structure so that, you know, there cannot be, the cracks cannot happen due to this. So joints can be, you know, sometimes it is not in our hand, it happens, like construction joints. Sometimes expansion joints, which is in our hand during design, we have to give the expansion joints, so that the expansion and contraction should be controlled and cracks cannot happen. And shrinkage, of course, we all know that cement shrinks and shrinkage, cracks will be there. So if we can provide the joints properly, we can minimize that. And chemical changes are there always, because we deal with chemistry when we are dealing with cement. So there is always chemistry behind, and these are all chemical reactions which are continuously happening in our structures. One is ASR, I have already told you that this is alkali silica reaction. Carbonation, we all understand now what is carbonation. Acid attack, sometimes, you know, we talk about acid rains, or sometimes, you know, acid may fall on the floor or in the structure, so it can also deteriorate my structure. Freeze thaw action is not applicable here, but in high altitude area when there is a cold environment, the freeze thaw actions are there. Continuously there will be freezing and thawing cycle. So to avoid freezing and thawing, we cannot avoid freeze thaw cycle, but we have to live with it. But we have special additives for the concrete. We can add that to minimize the problems which can happen due to freeze thaw cycles in the concrete. So we have that. We have, and many times corrosion can happen. So corrosions can be minimized with some protective measures. with some protective coatings which can protect our concrete structures for years. So we can design that. So thus, these are the factors which can be responsible for the aging process of the concrete, faster aging process of the concrete rather, and as a result, the loss of aesthetic value. Of course, if it happens, so, I mean, can it look like, you know, like the, like, can it be very good to look like? No. So the structure would be, you know, very dirty, or it's a very bad structure to look at. So we do not want that. So these are the things we must come out from this, and we need to have some precautionary measures which will be associated with the waterproofing treatments. Now we have to understand waterproofing very, very carefully. How can we protect my structure, or how can we enhance the life of the structure? So these are the measures we will be discussing today. Now, you know what, I am into specification many years I am into specification. I prepare the specifications for the consultants. So, you know, whenever I discuss with the consultant, I ask him few questions. Suppose that my consultant is preparing some documents which will be associated with basement, roof. Suppose he is creating some buildings. So I need to ask, suppose this is a basement, I need to ask few questions like, what would be the water table? Is it a single basement or double basement? If it is double basement, the system will be different. If it is dry, single, normal basement, the system will be different. If it is a rooftop, then of course there will be occasional rainfall, and it is constant under UV. So the system would be different from basement. If I am talking about the wet rooms, the toilet waterproofing, we call it wet rooms because water will be there all the time. So these are called wet rooms. In wet rooms, there can be balconies also. There can be kitchens also. So in these areas, there can be water for longer period. And that is why we call them wet rooms. So for wet rooms, the system would be different. For water tanks, there can be another system. So we need to ask questions first. We have to understand what would be the exposure of water and the exposure time of water. In the rooftop, there will be occasional exposure. In basement, there would be water all the time outside the structure because this is underground. In wet rooms, there can be water almost all the time. So the exposure time of water is very important, and according to that we need to take decision of waterproofing. Now of course many external points are also there, like UV. So our rooftops are constant under UV. So depending on that, we need to have different specifications, different precautionary measures. If the structure is under constant vibration, like, you know, in power plants, in TG buildings, there will be constant vibration. So whatever we will be using in that building, it should be extremely flexible to take care of the vibration. Hydrostatic pressure, we have already told you what is hydrostatic pressure. The basement, It is very good example of this. It is under constant hydrostatic pressure. And of course, the chemicals which are in the environment. Due to pollution, there will be many hazardous chemicals in our environment. We have to live with it. So what can we do? It is not in our hand, but what can we do? For our structures, we can take some precautionary measures with protective coatings. Now, this type of situation can happen in concrete. Cracks, this is a perfect example of honeycombs. So this kind of situation may come in the concrete. So what can we do for that? So I will be discussing now in my other slides. Now, since we have discussed about this building, this and the waterproofing of the building projects, it is our normal practice that we always call it 360 degree encapsulation. Why it is 360 degree? Normal roofing, normal basement waterproofing, normal wet room systems we can always do. But 360 degree encapsulation is associated with the outer wall waterproofing also. Many a times we see that cracks appear on the outer wall. So have we done anything to waterproof our outer wall of the building? If there will be cracks, then we need to have something at least to protect our outer wall from the environment. We have some solutions for that. I will show you. So this is 360 degree enveloping of the structure. So we have entire solution for a building, the entire waterproofing solution for the building, for the all the details of the building, I mean wherever possible. These are all probable areas, possible areas we have captured in our slide, and we have solutions for that. Now here comes our building waterproofing, right? We have already said that we have solutions for our buildings. What are the basic areas which should be completely watertight? The rooftop, you can see the above is rooftop. And this water weight room areas, these are the very, very basic thing. So you can see this is our building. The rooftops should be, this is a very basic building where there can be a rooftop and there can be weight rooms. So these are the basic areas we need to waterproof it. Now the basement. If suppose there would be basement in a structure, so we need to identify this basement first. If it is low water table, then we will call it a dry basement or simple dry basement. Then the system would be something like some membranes, some normal membranes called APB modified bituminous membranes, or some coatings. Coatings means two component acrylic cementitious coatings. These are very, very basic things. Two component acrylic cementitious coatings, very important in today's world, because this is almost an universal waterproofing product for entire building. These two component cementitious material, acrylic cementitious material, you can apply on basement, you can apply in weight rooms, you can apply at the rooftop also. But the design would be different. And how would you design? That is the main thing. Slowly you can do this. And of course, if the water table would be very high, then some technologies would be associated with it. Some critical things will be associated with it. So this is no longer a normal material, a normal solution. This solution will be associated with technologies. Technologies means membranes, some tough membranes. Okay, and some detailings, of course, with this. So nowadays, the market demand is with HDPE membranes, PVC membranes. So these are the membranes which can be applied when the water table would be very high, and when we deal with some double basement, triple basement, etc., etc. Now these are the retaining walls. You know, in the basement, I forgot to tell about the layer of the basement. So the first layer would be PCC. We already understood what is PCC. The plain cement concrete. So the first layer of the horizontal level of the basement will be created with PCC, and waterproofing layer would be just after this PCC. And after PCC, the waterproofing course would be done, and over waterproofing there will be some protective screed or something, and then there can be RCC. This protective screed is very much important, or some protective layers would be very much important over my waterproofing layer, because if we are creating RCC directly over that, then the rods would be there. So during rod binding, we may puncture the waterproofing layer. So the protection of waterproofing layer is very much important, and then the RCC. And for the retaining wall, when we are talking about a basement, there would be walls. So we call it retaining walls. So the retaining walls is directly, retaining walls would be directly the vicinity of the earth, right? There will be the earth, there will be the soil layer just beside that, and one face would be in the basement. So in the soil layer, in the outer layer, there should be the waterproofing, not from inside. So we in the basement, we call the phases like, you know, the positive side and negative side. What would be the negative side? The inside of the basement will be negative side, and the positive side would be the outer face of the basement. So the in the positive side, always you have to have the waterproofing for the retaining wall and as well as for the horizontal substrate, because you are applying waterproofing layer over the PCC and below RCC. Below RCC means over RCC you are not putting waterproofing layer. So it is below RCC means it is outside RCC. That means we are not doing anything inside of the structure. We are actually doing waterproofing outside of the structure. So that is why that we have to do waterproofing at the positive side of the basement. Please remember this thing. This is very important. Waterproofing should be done at the positive side or outside of the basement. And from the negative side, waterproofing cannot be done. Negative side means inside. Now for the retaining wall, since we have to do positive side waterproofing, then we have to select the soil side of the retaining wall, and we need to put something, the waterproofing layer, from the positive side. And then I have to protect my waterproofing layer from the soil, because I know there would be many hazardous chemicals in the soil, and I have to protect my waterproofing layer from these chemicals. Suppose this is two component acrylic cementitious. This is a very basic thing. If I am doing this with this, if I am doing the waterproofing with this, then I have to create some plasters, at least 15 mm plaster over my waterproofing. So these are the small things which should be known to everyone when we are designing the waterproofing design. These are very basic thing actually. Now coming to some isolated footings like this, you know, this kind of structures may happen in the basement. So this, for this isolated footing, we need to have something like some protective coating. Sometimes we can also waterproof it with the conventional systems, but this can also, this situation can also come when we need to have some protective coatings over that. So what kind of protective coatings are generally used? Coal tar epoxies. Coal tar epoxies are the chemicals. These chemicals have, various use when we are talking about some protection of the underground structures. Coal tar epoxies can be applied structures which are above the ground also for protection. This is absolutely a black material. The look would be black. So whenever we'll be doing this above ground, so we need to have permission from our consultants where to do what. But for underground section, you can always use, nobody is bothered about black colors for underground sections. So we can always use this. So for suppose a basement is at the seashore area, then also sometimes we can apply this type of things for the retaining wall, outer side of retaining wall, to resist the hazardous chemicals in that soil. Or sometimes this for this isolated footings also, we can use this. We have a variety of this materials. One variety is moisture insensitive also, so that we can apply this moisture insensitive. That means, due to moisture, it doesn't deteriorate. So it can also take care of moistures. So it is moisture insensitive, so we can apply it blindly in underground structures. This is the typical cross section of DPC. You know, this damp proof course is very much important when we talk about a normal building. So many a times actually our contractors do not do this, but the good practice is always to do something for the damp proof course. So this is, you can see that blue line. The blue line is actually the damp proof course. This is waterproofing line, and this is damp proof course with some waterproofing material. So here you can apply some coatings, some conventional coatings, like, you know, this SBL latex or some acrylic emulsions punched with cement. So we can always apply that, or sometimes some membranes also. You know, the APP membranes are being used. So damp proof course is very much important. This is the basic level. If there will won't be any basement, then that would be the basic level of the waterproofing of any building. So we must do something at least for DPCs, because, you know, the buildings in salt lake areas, that damp proof, that many a times we see the efflorescence, the damp patches are coming, you know, at this plinth level. So this is very much important. If we can do properly the damp proof course, then it can be minimized. And the wet areas, I have already told you, the wet areas means the toilets, the balconies, the kitchens where there will be water. So we need to have some waterproofing. The base practice is always we do it. This is our normal practice. You please also inculcate in your practice so that the waterproofing would be complete. So if we talk about two component acrylic cementitious, this is very important. This two component acrylic cementitious or something else for the horizontal portion of the horizontal slab of the bathroom, toilet, whatever, then we must take it also up to the shower level. Many a times it happens that the adjacent room just beside the toilet, you know, the damp patches may come from the wall and it looks very ugly. So up to the shower level, at least you take it the waterproofing course, so that it would be complete. The waterproofing would be complete. And of course, the detailings, the most weak part is, you know, this the weakest part of this waterproofing, in the toilet, would be that pipe penetration. So the pipe penetration, when you are dealing with, you need to have extra precaution. Like, you know, here you can see in the slide that the pipe, you know, it is protruding, and the beside the pipe there would be then annular portion which should be filled up with some non-shrink material. So suppose if, you know, we all know that cement shrinks. So if we do it, if we fill it with some normal cements and mortar or some normal polymer modified mortar, it can shrink over time. So, but we do not, we cannot expect cracks there, because these are the most important vulnerable part in the bedrooms. So there it should be filled up with non-shrink grouts, which won't shrink. And after that, there would be, you know, cementitious membranes. Of course, cementitious, if it is cementitious membranes, then with the annular portion, with the pipe penetration, we need to have some extra precautions with some geotextile cloth and with some PU-based membrane. You know, the PU-based membranes, the flexibility of any PU-based membranes would be higher than the cementitious barrier. So if we properly, we can take care of those portions properly with some flexible materials and with some reinforcements, with some geotextile or glass fiber cloths, then it would last long, it would be durable. And of course, over that there can be tile would be fixed. And if you are fixing tiles, you can fix it with tile adhesives. This is also a good practice. And with tiles, there will be joints, tile to tile joints. You can always fix it with tile grouts. Actually, you know, this tile fixing adhesives or tile to tile filling materials, these are not normal cementitious materials. These are associated with polymers, so that there won't be any crack in the future. So these are all chemistries behind that. 2 coats of waterproofing are must for the toilet waterproofing, and above that, these are the things. So you can now, realize the solution of the wet rooms. So this can happen in reality. Now, you know, I have already discussed about the positive side waterproofing, right? What is positive side? That is the outer side of the structure. That is positive side. From where the water is coming. That is the positive side. Now, if we deal with, suppose a swimming pool. Here you can see a swimming pool. Here you can see a water tank. Then in swimming pool, what would be the positive side? The inside. Because water is there inside. We have to understand one thing properly. We have to remember always, positive side means the water side or the outer side of the structure, sometimes for the basement. But from where the water is coming, the source of water, where it is, that would be the positive side. Here in swimming pool, water is inside. Then inside would be the positive side. In the water tank, drinking water tank, the overhead water tank, what would be the positive side? Inside. Water is inside there. But if I talk about underground water tank, then what would be the positive side? Both the sides would be the positive sides. Because in underground water tank, the inside there would be water. And since it is underground, the soil sites, there will be also positive side, because water may come from outside also. Water is there out in the outside. So both the sides would be the positive sides. I hope you understood this. Now these are the underground tanks. I have already told you, for underground tanks you have to have some measures from outer sides also and insides also. because both the areas are positives. Outer side waterproofing, we all know how to do it now with some coatings or with some membranes we can do. From inside, if suppose there will be drinking water inside, so we have to have something which is food grade. You know what, you know, we have many food grade materials also. Epoxies can be food grade sometimes, polyurethane can be food grade sometimes, two component acrylic cementitious can be food grade. So we have all. But whenever, try to remember one thing, whenever you are designing something, designing the waterproofing, so please do not forget to have something food grade when you are dealing with some drinking water specification. So it's very important. Now the terrace, normal terrace will be, you know, the structure where there will be UV always, there will be occasional rainfalls. I mean it must withstand storms, it must withstand weather change because this is exposed to weather. So whatever we are applying here, it should withstand the change of weather. Sometimes, you know, these are few pictures for you. Sometimes we talk about acrylic membranes, which are pure acrylic. That is not acrylic cementitious. These are pure acrylic. So that, you know, that it can be applied over the roofs. Sometimes it may be associated with 3 coats, 2 coats, whatever. But these coats are generally can actually remain exposed to take care of the weather condition. Because, you know, these type of membranes have, special features, like it can withstand UV. That is why we call them UV stable materials. Sometimes it may be associated with some fibers in it so that it doesn't crack. So some formulations are associated. We can play with the formulations of the materials to take care of the environment. So these are very, very basic acrylic materials. These are pure acrylics which are UV stable, so you can apply these where the footfalls would be very less, then you can do it. Or otherwise, if footfalls are very high on the rooftop, it is better to conceal those systems with some protective screens. Now this kind of roof also may come, right? These are metal roof with corrugations over that. Ups and downs are there. So how would you fix this? We have membranes for that. We have very special membranes, actually 1.5 mm thick. This is a very thin membrane compared to other membranes like thick EPP membranes. These are thin membranes, 1.5 mm. And so that it can take care of ups and downs very easily. If the membranes would be thicker, then we cannot handle those ups and downs with these thicker membranes easily. So if the membranes should be necessarily thin, and this is with 1.5 mm here, and it is self-adhesive membrane with some primers. And whenever you are preparing specifications with this kind of membranes, this is actually EPP membranes. So the plain finished EPP membranes are not UV stable. So whenever you are dealing with something of that sort, you need to have some reflective paint over that. So here we have done with some bituminous aluminium emulsion we have applied over there, over this membrane, so that it can reflect it and my membrane doesn't come under UV directly. This type of roofs also may come. This is called this we have done with liquid applied membranes and preformed membranes are two sections of the waterproofing membranes. Preformed means membranes which come from factory with some roles. So we have to unroll those membranes, like APP membranes. These are already, you know, the design, that the size is already predefined. It comes in rolls, so we have to unroll it. And sometimes we need to deal with some liquids. So some liquids are there which we can apply over the roof, and after curing it forms a membrane. Then it is called liquid applied. Okay, so here you can see we have done the roof with some liquid applied membranes, which is white in color, and this white colored liquid applied membranes actually can reflect heat, and inside there can be a cool roof kind of environment. Okay, so these are the materials you can always apply when the footfalls would be very less on the roof, and this can remain exposed. Sometimes we may come across the roof gardening thing. So many a times the consultants ask about the structures. I mean, they discuss about some podium slabs, the rooftop slabs, which they can convert to gardens, green roofs. We call them green roofs. So we have solutions for that. We have systems for that, which should be necessarily anti-root. Okay, so whenever the system, the waterproofing system, will be applying for the green roof, it should be necessarily anti-root also. Okay, so these are the things, these are the small things we need to remember always, but always, always remember one thing, we need to waterproof the mother slab, the base slab first, and then over that there can be the anti-root layer. Okay, so we will not do anything like waterproofing cum anti-root only once. For roof gardens, for green roofs, there should be two layers of waterproofing. Okay, so this is the picture, you can see the picture. So this is the cross section of this this thing, actually this green roof. And of course, sometimes we need to insulate our roof to minimize the temperature inside, so it can give us the cooling effect inside. So the insulation systems are actually of two types. One is preformed insulation blocks. Sometimes we call them extruded polystyrene polyurethane blocks. So this can be insulation blocks, or sometimes, which I have already told you, some liquid applied membranes have features in this. It can withstand, it can reflect heat so that the temperature inside would be less. So the both way we can do. So this is called this type of things, actually the liquid applied membranes which have this cool roof kind of effect. This will be always with high SRI. SRI means solar refractive index. Solar refractive index. If the SRI is just an index, a point. If the SRI value increases, then you will be sure about its reflectivity, heat reflectivity, UV reflectivity. So it would be a very good, it will have a very good UV reflection property, and the inside the temperature would be less. So it should be necessarily with high SRI, and of course it should be exposed always. So for the high footfalls over the roof, we cannot apply this type of coatings. Then we have to do with some preformed blocks, insulation blocks, and then over that there will be a PCC. Okay, so two types of roofs can be there. So we need to understand the need of the consultant or the end user. Now, of course, we have materials which has SRIs like 103 also, and which has 1110 also. So we have, both the systems. So these are the normal acrylic membranes which we have, which can have SRI 103, And there will be first the surface preparation. Surface preparation is a must to install anything, anything, anywhere in the structure. You first need to do a proper surface preparation. You need to clean the surface. You need to grind the surface. You need to fill up the cracks. You need to correct the imperfection, and then only you are in a position to install anything. So surface preparation, then the first layer of primer. Primer is very important. Primer is the bond enhancer. Primer will give you the bond between the top coat and the substrate. It will enhance the bond. So primer is always necessary. So primer, then the first coat, then one glass fiber cloth can be there, and then the second coat. So glass fiber cloth or geotextile membrane can be sandwiched between two coats, so that it will give some extra strength of the material, so that it doesn't crack easily. So these are the systems. Now, high SRI indexes are also possible with materials like 113. We have that. And this is exactly the same way we can install. Suppose the client has demand of this SRI. So in that case, we have to switch over to this, and we need to create this type of specification. Sometimes this polyurethane which we have, this is a water-based polyurethane system. Water-based polyurethane. Water-based is very important nowadays. Nowadays, we are very much, conscious about the greenhouse effect, the pollutions, etc., etc. So we need to prepare, we need to make green buildings more. So for green buildings, you need to have something which will not be hazardous, because we deal with chemicals every day. So the chemicals should not be hazardous, should not have any health threat. So it would be completely green. So we have water-based things with us. So it can be with primer, and again the two top coats with this sandwiched with a glass fiber cloth. So these are the things. It will it may have 109 SRI also if we apply wide variety of that, because this type of membranes will have 4 or 5 varieties of colors. So if we apply wide, then we are sure about SRIs. And of course, the outer wall waterproofing, I have already told you, we have promised to our end users that we will create 360 degree encapsulation, and it is there. So we can create the entire wall, we can convert the entire wall watertight with some elastomeric waterproofing acrylic treatment. So we have that membranes which liquid applied membranes which will have 300% elongations. So in two coats we will be applying this with a primer, and it can comes in colors, so anybody can choose the colors for it. So we can give. And of course, polyurethane is a chemistry. Polyurethane or polyurea, nowadays we talk about this type of polymers off and on. So these type of things comes with chemistry. So we need to understand the chemistries and the features of polyurethane. This is completely seamless. Whenever we will apply this liquid applied thing, it will not have any joints. This is completely seamless, jointless situation. And it has high crack bridging ability, because these are necessarily flexible things. So it can take care of cracks. It has excellent bond with the substrate. The substrate on which we are applying this, it has excellent bond. It is, of course, UV stable. It can reflect heat. It has high durability. And for this, we do not want any skilled labor, because this comes in buckets. This comes in liquid form. So we can apply this and wherever possible. And of course, it can be also applied whenever we talk about some refurbishment of roof. Matlab, if it is a old roof, there will be some bituminous membranes already laid, then we can apply this type of membranes over that without removing the old membrane. It is also possible. And these are the things which can be with water-based and solvent-based. In water-based, there can be two types of things, two components, single component. And in solvent-based, there can be two types of situations. One is single component and one is two components. Now, these are the technicalities, you know, technical things in a slide. I am just showing you to show some properties. I'm not elaborating it. So you can see, I mean, with this slide, there are many properties associated with this single component. 1K means single component, 2K means two components, so 1K, 2K systems. So these are highly flexible materials. You know, we can also achieve 700% elongations with this. So we can just imagine how flexible these are. And of course, polyurea. Nowadays, we talk about polyurea membranes. Polyurea, this is the third generation one. Polyurea have properties superior to polyurethane even. And these are also, again, joint lace. This is sometimes this is UV stable, depends on the formulations. And it has a very good bonding with concrete and metal both. And it is, of course, it is for the existing PU coatings, sometimes we can apply as a top coat also. Because this is a costly material, this comes with a cost. So, we have to understand the client's budget. And according to that, we need to prepare the things. And polyurea, you know, it's a very sophisticated material. You know, it has two varieties actually. One is brush applied. This is the normal one. Anybody can apply. And one is spray applied. And that is, you know, the spray applied things cures in 3 seconds. So for that, you need to, the applicators, the contractors need to have 25 lakhs to 30 lakhs of, machineries. They have to invest a lot in that machineries to install this kind of membranes, which cures in 3 seconds. So polyureas have that variety also. But these are very, you know, good material, and these are the most superior. If we imagine a product pyramid, probably it will belong to the tip of the pyramid. These are the polyurea system. This is brushable polyurea. And we can apply this. And we have done this successfully in Cipla. I will show you some case studies. Yeah, this is the case study with polyurea. You can see the pictures. We have done it in Cipla. The roof of Cipla has been done with this brushable polyurea. And you can see from the, you know, side pictures, you can see how it is being applied. Now, this is Cyber City, Hyderabad. We have done the terrace waterproofing. You can see this job site pictures. This is another job site picture from the Gujarat. This is a power plant roof, actually. So this is with this we have applied with chaluritane LHM. This has high elongation, highest elongation actually in our product basket, that is 700%. You can see some pictures, there's basement pictures, basement waterproofing pictures with some membranes. This is HDP membranes in Barmer refinery. We have done this. And this is Ramakrishna Mission, Raigarh. This is the entire roof. And at the same time, that expansion joint are being sealed with the materials, the joint materials. This is the tape materials actually. So this is the way. This has been done. And now this is, I'm at the end of my presentation. Safety is a must. We must be safe in today's scenario. So we must stay safe, stay inside. And this is the whole story about the waterproofing. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam. And many thanks to you for giving us such an wonderful lecture about waterproofing and roofing. And obviously this will be very helpful to all the participants for their current study and their future life also. So now we have some question and answer round.
Please.
So dear participants, if you have any doubts, please write in the chat box. Okay, we have only 5 minutes, so if you have any doubt or any queries, any questions, please write in the chat box. Okay.
Acha, was I audible?
Yes.
Because Virup was asking me about that, so.
No, madam. No problem.
Okay.
So.
Please, you can ask me any questions.
Hmm. Actually, at the very beginning, there was some issue with the audio, but afterwards it was okay.
Oh, fine. No problem. How were the expansion joints are waterproof? Fine. Absolutely. Expansion joints, you know, for expansion joints, we have sealants. These are the conventional sealants like polysulfide, polyurethane sealants for the expansion joint treatments. And you have asked a very good question, because the sealants are, you know, the basic rule, basic principle of sealants is to watertight the joints. Sealants we use for watertightness of the joints. First, number one. And number two, to take care of the contraction and expansion of the structure. So many a times we are wrong to, you know, in our communication, that we always talk about the expansion and contraction first. But we need to remember one point, that sealants are necessarily used. The primary use of the sealant is to make a watertight joint, and then second is the expansion and contraction. So we can apply sealants in the expansion joints, and sealants have movement accommodation factor to some extent. So it can be flexible with the structure. So it can take care of the expansion and contractions. The polymers are associated with this polysulfide and polyurethane, most of the cases. So this can be two component or sometimes single components also. So different grades are also available, polyurethane and polysulfide. And if the expansion joint, width goes beyond 40 mm, then there is a different solution for that. Then the system is with a tape, just like a band-aid, you know, some tapes are available. So it will be attached to the substrate of both the sides with some epoxy adhesives. It would be adhered, and the mid position would be free to take care of expansion and contraction. So these are the main chemistry, the story of expansion joints. So we can do it like this. I hope you understood. Can I get the slide through mail to see it?
This is a request, madam.
Okay. I mean, you please get in touch with me. I will definitely share with you.
Okay,
but I think it has been recorded.
Yes.
So you probably will have the entire session with you.
Yes.
So you please forward this, share with them.
Sure.
That they can get the... ma'am, kindly please, can you just repeat the part? What should we do to reduce the temperature, and for that, what type of waterproofing should we do at the terrace? Fine. To reduce the temperature, this is called what? You know, the cool roof technology. So inside we can, reduce the temperature by applying some materials which comes in liquid. We can apply liquid applied membranes over our rooftop so that it can reflect heat. And it has to be white in color with high SRI, and it has to be UV stable, so that it can reflect heat, it can reflect light, and inside there will be a cool roof kind of feeling. So that is what know that this kind of liquid applied membranes or LAMPS are, I mean, with high SRI it comes actually. So whenever the SRI value, this index will be high, there will be, you know, temperature would be, I mean, it can reduce temperature better. The reduction of temperature would be high. So if the SRI, the solar refractive index will be high, then the temperature decrease would be high also. So this type of materials can be put over the rooftop to minimize the temperature. Okay.
Madam, one more question.
Does the foundation or tie beam need to be waterproofed? Yeah, of course. Tie beam, how can you waterproof, dear? This is the main structure. Again, I'm telling you, you need to remember one thing. Waterproofing should be done at the positive side. At the foundation level, at the underground level, it should be done at the positive side, means over the PCC and below the structure, below RCC. So my waterproofing job would be complete when I complete my waterproofing over PCC, not the RCC. RCC will come later with its tie beams, everything. So the structure may be, so it will come later. I have no role. My waterproofing has no role with this. My waterproofing would be on PCC, outer side of the structure. Thus, actually it would be watertight, of course, because from outside water cannot come inside then. And this way it can be watertight. But directly anything I cannot put.
Thank you, madam.
I hope you understood that waterproofing would be done always at the outer side, at the positive side.
Ma'am, in case of rigid pavement for highway, how can it be?
Highway, the technology is completely different. This comes under roads. So for the rigid pavement, of course, we have some features for that. To make it watertight, we have a slurry seal for the roads. We have slurry seal RSTC, which we call slurry seal for the roads. This is actually polymer modified slurry seal, which can be spray applied over the rigid pavements or flexible pavements also. We can apply that so that the pores would be filled up with this and there will be no water percolation. Because we understand that whenever, you know, rainwater falls, the water percolates through the pores and ultimately the blisters happen and the potholes form. So that way we can, waterproof our roads, but many a times, contractors for the budget issues, they do not apply this. But yeah, of course, this is a very good practice. We can also create water tightness of the roads. And for the rigid pavements, the concrete itself can be made watertight with some admixtures.
Okay.
Yes, so admixtures are the very basic ingredient can be added into concrete so that the concrete can be made watertight.
Okay.
So that is another technology. So this way we can do it.
So ma'am, can you have this type of slide for rigid pavement? Do you have any slide regarding this rigid pavement waterproofing?
Yeah, I have, but in this session, I have not shown you. We have another session next day. I will definitely keep it in my mind that I will definitely show you some slides on that.
Okay. Thank you.
Madam, one more question from Vishal Shah.
Yeah, ma'am. If there is swimming pool on the terrace, then how do you run?
Yes, it's a very good question. Actually, nowadays we talk about rooftop swimming pools also. So I think now you have understood that for swimming pools, the entire
entire that area from inside should be made watertight. After casting of the slab, you know, the entire slab should be made watertight. But how? Actually, we need to do injection grouting for that. Injection grouting is, you know, there would be joints or there can be imperfections in the concrete. We need to do injection groutings there. We need to create holes and we need to fix some injection points and we need to fix some pipes, small pipes, and then we need to do injection grouting through these pipes. That means we are injecting something, the polymers with some cements, which can be injected through the concrete so that we can minimize the pores and voids or honeycombs in it. So we can inject material so that it can be completely watertight. And then after injection, we need to fill up the swimming pool with water and we need to inspect whether there will be any drop of water inside or not. If we are okay with it, if the water tightness achieved, then we need to apply some coatings or membranes into it. Then there would be the protection and then tile fixings and all. So this is the specification of the swimming pool waterproofing, and for rooftop obviously we need to have extra precautions.
Okay, thank you madam.
Thank you so much.
We are concluding here now, and
thank you.
On the next day we will meet again for
yes.
the next lecture, sustainable innovative solution to flooring in modern construction. The sure. next Saturday, 19 June at 1:30 p.m.
Yeah, the same time we will be meeting.
Yes. Okay. Thank you madam once again.
Thank you so much.
So dear all, so now we are concluding here. Okay.
Thank you
to all of you.
Thank you.